All right, I'm recording now. We will be starting with Freya today. So all these bosses, we're going to go over normal first, and then I'm going to show a hard mode version. I'm going to try and be better about showing visuals at all times and less web page, so it's a bit more interesting. But we are going to go over the trash. So pretty much Freya is just one room to the left of Thorim. There's not much in between, just two of those colossus that you kill at Korhounds.
Reggie.
So coming in here, most of this trash in this whole room is pretty straightforward and zuggable. You have some lasher packs that you can just straight up group up and cleave. These other packs you're gonna have, I'll go back to the actual pull of these, but they're really not that complicated. This dragon is just gonna do a conal breath. The blade, nature's blade, he's pretty much ignorable. He'll kill him second. The main thing you're gonna focus here is the Ent, the mangrove Ent, and that guy is just straight up a druid healer, so we're just gonna focus him down. And then there's one other minor add here. I can't really see. It's not really that big of a deal though. Aside from pretty much all you're doing here is grouping up and cleaving. Sorry, they'll spawn hurricanes. You'll see to the right there, there's a hurricane. We just move it out when it spawns. Aside from that, we're just cleaving down and ideally killing that first. This raid wasn't very organized, so it is what it is. Nothing really to worry about. Now, how Freya's room works is it's essentially a big circle. Sorry, it's a bit small here on the minimap. You'll see a little green area, an orange area, and a purple area. In each area, there will be some trash, and there will be a keeper of Freya. And so essentially, these are kind of like the towers on Flame Leviathan, but I know we haven't talked about Flame Leviathan, but they're little mini-bosses that, when you kill them, you make Freya easier. Freya hard mode, all it is you don't kill any of these adds. And so you'll still clear the trash around Freya just so you can, you know, have room in the room. You're not pulling extra mobs while you're doing the boss. But you don't need to kill these keepers, which is another benefit to doing Freya hard mode. It's just less trash clear time. So let's get into, let me just quickly show you the abilities of the keepers. They all kind of have their own stick. Find in here.
Elder.
Of course. Pretty much, they're very straightforward. They all just have one mechanic. Brightleaf, his main thing is he's gonna make solar flares, and I'll show that in a minute. Kind of want to get them in order here. I believe the first one we're dealing with is gonna be Stonebark. Sorry, I know the three mechanics, but I forget which one does which. Okay, so the first one is going to do Fist of Stone and Ground Tremor. You can pretty much just annoy this. It's like a Thorns thing. So what's going to happen is the Ground Tremor, this ability, pretty much it's a cast. And when it finishes, it interrupts the whole raid spell casting. So what you do one of two things. You either stop casting right before it goes off, just like a PvP kick. Or you're going to use Imp Conqueror, and see, there it is right there. It's uninterruptible, and if you're casting during this, it's also going to do a lot of damage. Nothing, you know, uncontrollable, but obviously DPS just need to control that, or we'd use an Imp Conqueror Mastery. The other thing, the Fist of Stones, essentially what it does is just gives them a buff that will just one-shot a tank. And so what you do is the off-tank, literally an off-tank or a hunter, just taunts and runs away at that point till the buff goes away. Honestly, I think we kill him so quick here that we don't even get it. So it's not that big of a thing, it's just something you should be aware of.
Is that one of those things where it's like you have to taunt before the cast bar, taunt before whatever?
Yeah, so you would use improved concentration aura. Sorry, was that the question?
Yeah.
Yeah, and so improved concentration aura will, I think, make you just immune to interrupts and silences while it's active. So that's going to be a lot more important next phase, specifically in this encounter and a couple others like Ignis. I think currently we are only really using that mechanic for, I think there's maybe, I'm blanking on what it is. I think we use for
We use it for Feralina.
Feralina, that boss, yeah, sorry. So this is the green area here. Next we're gonna do the orange area, and what's the last guy's name here? Elder Iron Branch. I believe I know Iron Branch. He is very simple. He's just gonna root everyone. Pretty brain dead straightforward. Just you essentially, the roots are targetable, so you can damage them. So you just break everyone out, you turn and kill all the roots and go back to the boss. Additionally, he will impale a lot of damage to the tank, I believe, and stun them. Nothing, really nothing to be like concerned about. I just want to quickly go over what these guys are going to do. And what's important about each of these elders is when you leave one up, they will give one of their abilities to Freya to buff the encounter. And so Freya hard mode, you don't get the loot, as far as I know, until you leave three up, and more importantly, in terms of Algolon progression, we have to leave all three up. So we'll be attempting this as soon as week two. It's just one of the things we need to do to get to Algolon. So here's the roots. They're just placed on someone, you just break them out. It's really very simple. You can see the tank get impale right there. He takes a decent chunk of damage, but nothing too scary. You can use Pain Sub, Panda Sacks, probably not even needed. The last guy is going to be. Let's talk about some of the trash in between there. I believe we've talked about all the packs other than one. Let me just double check I didn't miss any. Yeah. So we have another Lasher pack coming up to him. When we cross the river here, we get more Lasher packs. And so this pack is what I want to talk about. So this Corrupted Servitor and Misguided Nymph. They're very straightforward, pretty much just tank and spank. The only gotcha on this one is this Misguided Nymph will apply a heal that's dispellable. If you dispel it will do massive, this thing right here, Vine Life, I believe that's it. If you dispel it will do massive AoE damage to anyone around it and pretty much one-shot the melee, and you're gonna see it here in a second. Pretty sure the raid leader even called not to do it. It's coming up here. I believe it happens in this raid. Think I have the wrong raid. Let me just show you that quick. So we kill these lashers. Go into this back, and so I believe she just cast it on the Corrupted Servitor. We can watch here to see if he gets a dispellable buff or themselves, but, anyways, they dispel it and it just one shots all the melee. So, really, that's the only thing we need to know about for this trash that's kind of mildly annoying. Aside from this trash is pretty base roll, and not too many packs.
So don't dispel.
Yeah, just don't dispel on this pack. Let me open the other one back. Actually, I can do it on this one, that's fine. So this is the last guy here, and he's very simple. He just makes these moonbeams, and you just kite him in a circle. That's all it is. Just don't let him be in the moonbeam, and no one else stand in it. And aside from that, it's tank and spank. Okay. I believe they just do AoE damage. We can double check here. Increases damage and healing done. Stacks up to 10 times. Canceled by this. And he does AoE damage or something. Really nothing to be too concerned about. But what will matter is what, when you leave them up, how they're going to buff Freya. Now, you're either usually just going to do straight up normal Freya or full heart mode. There's really not much reason to do in between. I believe you do get extra Crusader orbs. Or sorry, not Crusader orbs, Rune orbs. Or you can get extra patterns, but we're just probably going to go for the hardest difficulty, at least week two, because we want to get to Elgon, so.
I feel like everything's going to be a lot easier than it seems to be.
Yeah. The hard modes are still going to be hard, because a lot of stuff is just, like, one-shot shit that just kills you. So, like, if your raid is just, like, stand in void zones, like, it's going to be hard for you. But aside from that, I feel like a lot of DPS checks aren't going to be as hard as people think. Okay, so let's get to Freya. So we kind of clear the area here. And so Freya is padding around here by the waterfall, and she's just like a yellow mob. She's a red mob, but she won't actually attack you until you attack her. You can walk right straight through her, but if you use certain things, area effects, you can pull her by accident, okay? How Freya is going to work is there's phase one and phase two, and so phase one, the whole time during it, she is gonna have this crazy buff on her with like 100 stacks that just, it's like a heal over time, and it does so much healing that you cannot damage her in phase one. It's pretty much impossible even by our DPS. Like, it's supposed to be an amount that's literally almost infinite healing. Now, how you get rid of these stacks is she's gonna summon waves of adds. There's three different types of waves, and you need to do each type of wave twice. Whenever you kill the wave, it drops the stacks on her. So once you kill all six waves, you can start to deal damage to Freya, and then it just goes into almost a simple tank and spank, and you're in phase two. Okay? So we're just going to watch, and I'm going to explain the add phases. So we go ahead and pull. She does need to be tanked the whole fight. She is active in auto-attacking, so, and her threat table is still a thing. She might be tauntable, but the thing is, it's kind of like Sarth at the start. You just don't really care about your damage on her. So this is the first type of wave here. You have detonating lashers, and so these things are tanks, wet dream. Pretty much they just have no threat table, so the tanks just hate their life, and they just run all over the place. So additionally, aside from just, you know, hitting lightly, they're really not threatening. What's scary about them is when you kill them, they blow up just like Gothic or whatever. And so what happens is if you just kind of carelessly cleave everything down and are grouped up, they can just instantly nuke the raid. So you can see they're kind of just all over the place. What we kind of did here is we grouped them up, and then slowly, as they got lower health, we started to spread and kind of single targeted. Then you can coordinate raid sacks and all of that to deal with them. Now, this is what a kind of unprofessional or a casual guild will do, or a lot of pugs. This is not the best way to handle this, and we'll get to the hard mode video here later, but I want to show you how I would like to handle it. So just go to handful. Oh no. Recording the wrong screen.
Don't have it?
No, I have it. I'm recording the wrong screen though. Rip. Just move everything to the other screen and restart the stream, I guess. Sorry about that, guys. I'm gonna start restart the stream.
And I'm fresh.
Take it from the top.
Yeah, that's a big rip, dude. I was on a roll. Okay.
York's last fluffer.
So so you can see that now.
What are we supposed to be saying?
Super squat.
Everyone good now?
I don't know. What do you want us to be saying?
You just see the second screen. It's like YouTube right now, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay, so let me just find where they do this.
Knife one
now.
Here it is. So that spawn, and since they don't have a threat table, they're just gonna run to random people. So what this raid does is they all just stack up, okay, and just zug everything down. And then what we're gonna do, if we evenly kill everything and it's all gonna die together, it's very easy to time a typhoon or a thunderstorm, something like that, so that we just push everything out of the raid right before it blows us up, okay? So everyone's just stacked. Everyone starts running south here towards the entrance of the room, and we push the adds north, okay? So we'll use that with a combination of a raid sack and make this phase literally a joke, okay? And we'll actually kill it quicker than if we would have done single target. Make sense?
Mm-hmm. Well, do we want a rocket boot there? Or...
No, actually, there's going to be lots of other good points for rocket boots, and so I'll show you some of those. That's a good point. That's a good little interlude. So let me show you some of the stuff Freya is gonna do throughout the fight. Freya has some abilities herself. So throughout the ad phase, she's just gonna be casting these things. The first one, she's just gonna throw a nature bomb. There's really nothing you can do about this. It's just gonna do damage and it's a bit of a knockback. Okay. I guess you can spread. That's about it. The sunbeam, these are just like the other mob, you'll just see a beam of light come down and it does some damage, okay? Additionally, this is the healing mechanic, and that's about it. Hard mode, she's going to do even more abilities. The other thing that isn't here for some reason, I don't know why it's not there, but she will summon trees, and so the trees are called... I forget their name, but we're going to see them pop up throughout the fight. And essentially, if they fully grow, they like sprout up from small to big. And if they fully grow, they will heal not only Freya, but they will also heal all adds that are currently up. So those, when you see those trees, those are kind of the times when melee can rocket boot over to make sure it dies in time. I think it's about to happen here. So you see right there, that tree showed up. And then it's growing bigger and bigger and just needs to die before it reaches its max, otherwise it will heal everything. So that was a convenient one, but sometimes you're killing something and the tree spawns super far away, and so having rock boots for that cooldown is very powerful. The next group of adds is three different adds. They're called Stormlasher, Snaplasher, and Ancient Water Spirit. The Stormlasher is pretty straightforward. It's just a caster and you can kick him. He does do a decent amount of damage, so we want to make sure we rotate the kicks here. And so that's what a lot of melee that can kick can go on. The Ancient Water Spirit, he will just randomly charge at raid members. Aside from that, he isn't too scary. A tank should be able to tank both of these, but maybe during prog you want to split them up. The last mob is this Snaplasher, and so he has a stacking buff on him that essentially, as the lower health he gets... the more damage he takes, the more damage he'll deal in his auto attacks. Additionally, he'll move slower. So the strategy is usually you'll have a tank him to about 50% health. As you can see going on over kind of off screen here, he's getting cleaved down with everything right here. And then you'll see as he starts to get bigger and bigger and bigger, he becomes slow enough that you can just start to kite him. So usually you'll have your other off tank on this. Or optionally, if we want to have an off tank on each, you can have a hunter kind of just distract and shot him off and start kiting.
Oh, it's like that fucking Karazhan boss, right?
I'm not sure
what's going on. The Tin Man of Scare in there, I think?
Yeah, it's kind of like that, and it's just he gets worse the more damage you do. It's not really something you want to face tank. There's just so many other ways to deal with him. You can face tank him no problem the first 50%. And honestly,
you need somebody on Freya during that, or no?
You need someone on Freya the whole time.
So would it just be me tanking all that, or was
yeah? I think it honestly it'll probably just be Doze on Freya and you tanking all that. But the thing is, the Freya tank can also have an add or two. They can tank other stuff. And the thing is, Freya doesn't do any cleave or you can move her around through the raid. There's nothing to be afraid of where she's standing or anything like that. Now, a couple other notes about that. I've seen some strats where they don't have any tank on Snaplash. They just have a Hunter or some shit kite it the whole time. And most ranged DPS will be on the Snaplasher. Because melee don't really want to be on it in case they pull threat. It will probably just one-shot them. They can cleave it, but you know what I mean? The bigger it gets, the more scary it is. And DKs can help out a lot. They can Chains of Ice it and stuff like that. Mages can Nova it. All these adds are pretty CC-able. Now, the last thing I'll say about these is how these adds work is they're like the call in ZG. So they all need to die within 5 or 10 seconds of each other. If they don't, they'll respawn. So you'll see here, once we kill the first add, it's about to happen. You should see a DBM timer saying respawn.
Their core hunts, got it.
Yeah, I guess for some reason this clear doesn't have it, but my other one did. So Lifebender's Gift, that's what these trees are called. So we all turn and kill the tree. Okay? So that is possibly the most chaotic phase. The other two add phases are pretty straightforward if you do the technique right. The last one is actually the easiest, but can be deadly to a couple things. So the last one is just one big add that just is usually a tank. So we have one tank you can see on the bear here, and then the other tank is on, I think, on their prop heli or something. Yeah, prop heli. Now, how this guy works is he will apply a debuff to you where you just are silenced and can't cast anything. The only way to get rid of this debuff is he will spawn these spores around, and the spore will protect you. You see this little red spore buff? Or mushroom, sorry. This just means you're protected from this ability. So essentially the tank will just pull him over to a mushroom, and the mushrooms will grow up, and then they'll disappear, and you'll just need to move it to the next mushroom. Very simple, right? The kind of tricky part about this is during this phase, I don't think it actually does on normal, so we'll come back to that. The other thing I didn't mention is throughout the whole fight, she should be casting a Vash static charge, essentially. You'll see Nature's Fury here on Chalice. This is normal. This is happening. It's almost always on one person. It happens very frequently, and so you need to get out. In fact, actually, maybe it's just during this ad, this big ad. I'll double check here. Yeah, it's not happening now. It's just during that big ad. So during this big ad, you'll need occasionally. So Amptus has to get out here, and that's actually on the tank, so we need to max range. Then it's going to go someone else. Okay, so those are the three add phases. You kill them all once, and then you do it again. And it is completely randomized, so you can get the same one two times in a row. You don't know what order it's going to be in or anything. It's just who knows, okay? Once you kill all these, the fight becomes very straightforward. It's pretty much tank and spank, so let me skip up. So we finish our last three add phase, and then at this point, you'll see Freya's stacks go away. So before, Freya would have had a buff that stacks 25, 50, 7500 or something like that, and now it's gone. So now we can damage the boss. Now phase two, you'll see all these little green spouts just fell, kind of like Dire Maul East. And so how that works is she will constantly drop, she's casting a sunbeam there, and then she will cast one of those seedlings on where every single raid member is at the time. And see, you'll just want they went again. So the strategy is you just move her back and forth, and what happens is they grow, and then at the end they blow up and they'll do a knockback. So we kind of scuffed it a bit here.
Unless you actually kind of want to group up to make it so there's not,
yeah,
like...
So you're grouping on one side of the river. This is actually a really bad clear. Let me show you. hard mode.
You kidding, Aaron?
This.
Yeah, tell Iron to take smaller rips.
He's incapable. Okay, so they start phase two. See this green cast? That was a moonbeam, actually, but it should happen any second here. There they are. You'll see them on the right there growing, and so you just move it across. They're going to blow up over there. And then as soon as these ones come down, you're going to move it back. There they just went again. Now we move it back. Very straightforward. This whole fight is just a tank and spank with the moonbeams and all the other mechanics that have been happening the whole time. If you get to this point, the boss is a free kill. It really is, assuming you have enough people up. Okay? Any questions on normal mode before we get into hard mode? Okay, just one sec. I'm just grabbing a glass of water. I just want to have one little special note about how OP DKs are on this fight. It's literally like their best fight in Alduar. The exploding adds, you can just AMS it. Or you can IBF it. You don't have to be scared of literally anything in this fight as a DK, as long as you use your defensives correctly. And you can pretty much just stand in the middle and just suck everything. So let's get into the hard mode clear. So let me first talk about what's going to change. Okay, so when you leave Brightleaf off, I believe this is the one that does the moon fires, it's just going to increase the magic damage both her and her allies do, so all the adds. Additionally, she will cast the solar flares, a nuke that hits multiple targets. So I believe there's already the moonbeams, but there's additional flares, and these things are happening very frequently throughout the whole fight. So if you turn on the video of this, if anyone wants to watch it later, I can send it to you. They're constantly calling. It's going to be a cooldown. I think it's called unstable energy, where everyone just needs to be ready to move right after it gets cast, because it gets cast on people. Stonebark is going to increase her physical damage, but it's going to give her the ability to cast Ground Tremor. 2-second cast, does lots of damage, and interrupts spell casting. So once again, now we need to deal with improved concentration aura and weaving that with raid sacks the whole fight. And so this is what makes the hard mode very difficult. This mechanic here, essentially what's going to happen is you're going to have healers, like tanks are going to be getting trucked, and if the healers get interrupted, or we don't do the improved conquer, or just even healers not healing for a second while they're avoiding being interrupted, tanks can die, etc., and there's a lot of raid damage. So this is the big mechanic of the fight. The next thing is going to be Iron Branch, increased physical damage of the allies. The adds are now hitting harder as well. But now they can also cast Iron Roots, and it's just on a single target with a dot, and the roots, you just break them out. This is, of all the fights, the least scary. However, the 50% damage boost to the adds is, like, notable for tanks. It's saying here, if you, I think if you leave one up, it actually says to leave the roots one up because tank damage. I don't know how true that is. I don't think we're ever going to leave, like, I don't think we're going to do incremental difficulties for this boss. We're just going to go for the hardest right away. Any questions before I show it? And we'll just kind of power through, and that'll be it for you. Okay. So fight starts here. Add spawn. I'm going to show this whole phase because this is one of the more complicated one. The melee seem to be on the Stormlasher. They're kicking. Beam soon. So you'll see that. A tree spawns over there. They send a Fel Hunter and some ranged DPS to kill it. Ground Tremor came right there, so they had to deal with that. There's the beam. You see all those just shoot up, and it says unstable energy, move away. Everyone just gets out of them and goes back to being normal. So it looked like the melee was barely even on the Snapflasher here. Once again, this is the raid that groups all up, and they'll use Typhoon to get rid of these. Keep reset a fire totem over there, I believe. So once again, we're just waiting here. There's nothing really to kill other than the tree spawned at the back. He didn't go for it. Then we got the big guy. So Crown and Tremor came up there. You have to stop casting.
So what is interrupting?
Ground Tremor. It's a 2-second cast that Freya will do. And when it finishes, it's like an AoE kick. It will, anyone in the raid that was casting something, when she finishes that cast, they'll be interrupted and spell locked. And so either you just need to stop casting right before it goes off, or you improved concentration aura, and that will protect you from it. And we'll be calling those in situations where we can avoid having to stop casting, right?
Can you curse her so it's too longer than 2-second cast or no?
Can you, sorry, say again?
You know the curse that doubles cast time? What's it called?
Maybe. I'm not sure, to be honest.
Curse of Tongues?
Yeah.
I'm not sure. But it does happen on a DBM timer. It's very predictable. You can see on the right here.
Yeah.
Ground Tremor CD. And Unstable Energy, that's the Moom CD. Sorry, tripping over my words. I've been talking a lot and training people today at work. But, so, same thing. They're really just dealing with roots, tremors, and the beams. Aside from that, the fight is the same. It's just harder because everything's hitting harder. There's really, I don't even think her health gets buffed, to be honest. I think it's really just damage. So you just kind of need to do the fight perfectly on hard mode and deal with a couple other bonus mechanics. But it's just a very chaotic fight. That's pretty much it. And once again, just on hard mode, once you clear all the ad phases, it's a free kill for the most part. So they knocked them away again. That was their second one. Let's see what they have left here. I think just the one big guy. So there's the sunbeams. They get out of it. Everyone gets to the mushrooms that can. See the guy that just said run out on me? That's the static shock that's happening during the big guy phase.
Excuse me.
I believe the mushrooms also give you a damage buff or something. There's some other benefit, but you just won't be in. Pretty straightforward. And if you're a healer and you're not in them, you won't be able to heal. Or a caster, you'll be silenced. And then we get to the end, and I already showed you this once. They just move back and forth, and she dies. You, once again, just like the other keepers, you don't actually kill them, and then they become friendly mobs. Pretty long this phase still. Like, you need to do it correctly for a while. But yeah, she'll despawn. There should be some chest or something. Any questions on that before we go, Mibron?
Nope.
Okay, so the next boss, before I just want to go over the trash, these are the big two Corehound guys. If you don't kill them at the same time, they'll one-shot the tank. I think that actually happens in this video. Let me see. Yeah, see, our druid tank got killed because we killed one before the other, and so you just attack the tank. Yeah.
But I get a second life accident. Yeah.
So, this trash, all I'm going to say about it is this is the worst trash in all of Alduar. The good news is it's very skippable. The only thing that's mandatory is this first pack. Pretty much, I haven't done a ton of research, but this arachnoid destroyer, he's just going to leap on people and spray fire damage around him. What's scary is all the little adds, these clockwork mechanics. They will throw, I think they throw ice grenades, and they also blow up when they die, okay? So, there he didn't really seem to do it. But there's just a lot of damage. It's a bit uncontrollable. You'll see essentially a full raid wipe on this next pack. But essentially right here, what you should be able to do is we'll send most of the raid back to kind of the teleporter, and you just need a pally and a rogue, and you'll have that pally bop a rogue, and he just sprints through. And then as soon as the bop's gone, he pops evasion and rocket boots. He just keeps running for his life, gets to the end, and vanishes. At the end of this hallway, there's teleporter pads. So throughout all of Alduar, there's lots of little teleporters. And essentially, he needs to run through. At the end of the hallway, there's a tram, like between Stormwind and Ironforge. So you just take the tram, it goes to Mimron, you activate the teleporter, and now we can all go there. So we can skip pretty much everything through here. It's worth a shot, you know, week one. And if it doesn't work, we'll clear the trash in the meantime. A rogue can actually stealth through the whole hallway, but I've seen a video of it. It takes very long. Like, you really need to use some, like, ninja fucking skills and, like, avoid, like, padding mobs and stuff like that. Like, I mean, very small pads, like, back and forth and do it kind of perfectly. So it's kind of just a waste of time. So the strat is usually you just have a rogue book it through with Bob and then vanish. Thought it was that one we failed, wiped. Right here we wiped. So I don't know what happened if the tanks weren't just up, but when they jump, they stun as well. So I think also what happened is just all the healers got stunned. So you do kind of want to spread out because they're also doing these flame sprays. So it can be a lot of damage if you don't handle it correctly.
It is longer than 30 seconds. The run, you can pop rocket boots and then swap to TPC rocket boots, and you'll still have the speed effect from the first rocket boot.
Yeah. The thing is, though, he's going to be... Like, he does it unstealth. He's just doing... The rogue's doing it because he has sprint and vanish.
That's what I'm saying. It's like, if you need another one after sprint...
You shouldn't. Just sprint and rocket boots should be... It's not super far. Like, it's... You see on the minimap, it's here to here, pretty much.
Okay. Yeah. I think
it's actually you do it another way around. You rocket boots first because they're faster than sprint, but to get ahead.
Which rocket boots?
The new ones.
New ones are slow.
Well, I don't know. Whatever's fastest doesn't really matter.
I don't know if it takes you further, though.
So this is Mimron. You come down here, the staircase, and you get to Mimron. Once again, I think you need to hit him to start the mob. Or start the fight, or you press this big red button at the back. The big red button will enable the hard mode. We'll go over that in a minute. But a lot of these fights I want to go over normal, mainly because we'll probably full clear on normal first, especially since it's going to be hopefully on the PTR. Essentially, and the mechanics of the normal don't change between normal and hard mode. Usually they're just adding mechanics. So if you can do it on normal, you can kind of do it on hard mode. It's kind of also, we want to full clear everything on normal to get all the gear. So the normal mechanics are surprisingly a lot of what actually kills people on this fight. Firefighter, which is the hard mode pressing the button, does make it harder, but it really only adds one mechanic each phase. And then on top of it, there's fire, and we'll get to that. So Flame Leviathan's broken up into three phases. The first is going to be the tank phase, so just waiting for the pull. Once again, yeah, he's a red mob, but you have to hit him once to start the fight. So, pretty much in this phase,
you can just tank him in the middle. Some raids on hard mode, they're going to move him around more. So the first mechanic he'll do is landmine. So he'll shoot out like an umbrella volley that you'll see here in a second of landmines everywhere. And they look pretty much the exact same as the Blood Furnace landmines. These things will two-shot most plate DPS. You can usually eat one, but if you're low, it's going to kill you. So these things are no joke. And with all the other mechanics going on in the fight, it's very easy to just lose them in the mix of what's going on. So this is one of the things melee and others need to be very afraid of and very aware of. It's way harder to see than a void zone in most situations. One thing that DKs can do is you can pop AMS to soak some. Just don't blow up anyone around you when you do it. Now, what makes this mechanic harder is he does something called Shock Blast. It's just like the Assembly of Iron, also like Emelon and VOA for Phase 2, where it's just a cast, and if you're not out of there when it finishes, you'll die. So I'm running out here, and I don't get hit by it. So because
of this... How big
is
the range on that?
It's, I can play it again, but I think I just make it out, to be honest.
And then what's the cast time? I can't really see.
I'll play it again. It's coming up here. Shock Blast. Looks like
3 seconds,
I think, or four. Probably three. So proximity mines are on DBM timer. We know they're about to come out right here. So there they are again. Little volley around. So usually you just keep them in the middle so you kind of know where the mines are, so the range don't have to worry about them. On the hard mode, you need to move them around, so it gets a bit more complicated. The other thing going on in here is two abilities, Napalm Shell and Plasma Blast. Napalm Shell is essentially Brutalis Burn. It just doesn't chain between people. However, if you guys are near each other, I believe, so if it targets Pig Sticker and there's someone else around him when it hits him, I think it can chain. So it should only be inflicting one person. So we are also spreading around the Leviathan, the tank mech here. Now, this is one of the scariest parts on hard mode. It actually does a very fair amount of damage. In terms of raid assignments, someone kind of needs to be a dedicated healer for this, probably a Resto Druid. Now, the Plasma Blast is just like any other tank buster mechanic. He just does it on a DBM timer. I'm not sure if he has a cast bar. We'll see here in a sec. I don't think so. I think he just applies it, but it's a debuff, and then that's when you'll use your pain sub or any type of tank defensive. That is generally when you will use it as a tank in this fight. There's really nothing else threatening to a tank unless you stand in stupid.
Oh.
So that's pretty straightforward. I'm going to keep kind of chucking through these phases, but pretty much once you finish this, you'll go into phase 2, which is another part of the mech. This guy's, you know, like a Gundam anime. He's got, you know, a bunch of parts that form. Ultron or whatever. What's that, I forget what cartoon that is, but...
It's like Zoids.
Is it?
No.
It's like 50 different cartoons.
Yeah, it is a lot of different cartoons. Maybe Transformers so, even does it?
I mean, the main one you're probably thinking of Power Rangers, but...
Yeah, I guess that does it too. Anyways, the second one is the body of the mech. So the tank is technically the feet, this is the body. And so once again, why I say tanks should use their cooldowns is the rest of these mech fights, there's no other tank buster mechanic or anything that's scary. So much so that this phase is actually untauntable or untankable. There's no tank here. How it works is he will just rotate in essentially three pi kind of way, whole kind of face like a cone, and he's constantly shooting just it's kind of like the Brutalis cleave that's doing spread damage. So if he goes to any area and not enough people are there, it will do a lot of damage to you. So how this raid handled it is you see these three circles here, or how it's already divided in three pie slices, they just split up the raid so that way no one's ever taking too much damage. We'll get to how that can change a bit on the hard mode. The other thing he'll do is the Lurker Barrage. So you'll see here spinning up. It's uninterruptible. It's just giving you a heads up that this is coming. You get a TBM warning, and everyone now needs to get behind them. This is essentially, if you need to rock your boots on this fight, it's probably here to save your life. Okay, so everyone's just moving in a clockwise pattern, and just if this thing
like
hits
Lurker.
You, yeah, it's exactly like Lurker. It will one-shot you. It just doesn't knock back. It just kills you. There's no time to even get knocked back. You're just dead. Okay. Aside from that, I don't think he does... Oh, he does one other thing here, and it's called a missile strike. So you'll see this missile on his back. You'll see a little red targeting marker on the ground. In this video, you probably don't see it because I'm melee. But essentially, whole shootout, I believe 1 on 10 man and 3 on 25 man. There it is, I think over there. See right there, that red glow?
Yeah.
I believe that's it. Yeah, you could. It's right behind all my buffs, so it was very hard to see. It was right here. But essentially, you saw all those range just move there. I'll show it one more time. See if I can find a better one after. But it's just a telegraph thing, and I don't think this is on a DBM timer. They just need to see they're standing in stupid and get out before they die. And I believe that's also a one-shot mechanic. So we're now at pretty much 3 one-shot mechanics and 1 fight. And they're pretty much all don't stand in. This is the don't stand in stupid fight, pretty much. If you can do that, you'll kill. Now we get to phase 3. And phase 3 is the flying phase, or the head. And so this is the one that will use a ranged tank. Usually most people just use a demo lock. There might be a way a DK can do it, but I think it's pretty safe bet to just do a demo lock. I don't think they need to wear any extra special gear. I'm still figuring that out, but I believe it's arcane damage, so it's not like they have any special resist. Doesn't have to be a demo lock. I think it can be a hunter or anyone. You just heal them. So here, I believe it's Lyta.
We used an arcane mage back in the day.
Okay. Thanks, Psycho.
Or a shatter priest. Either one.
Yeah, that's probably good too, because dispersion.
Yep.
So... really not super important what you use, just someone that doesn't die.
Demo lock's a great option. Good high threat with searing pain and everything. So.
Yeah. So the other thing going on here is he will drop 2 types of adds on hard mode 3. Actually, there's 4 total, but most of them are not a big deal. These junk bots, just tank them, kill them, literally nothing too important about them. The salt bots, however, is kind of the DPS priority of this phase. The reason being, they will drop a core. It's like a lootable item. This is kind of like Bash. Just whoever gets it needs to then use it after. It's pretty simple, more simple than Bash. Essentially, they loot it. You'll see Semi got it over here, and you go over to the mob and you just press it. And what it does is it says it's a magnet and it will pull him to the ground. During this time, he is stunned and takes increased damage, and so that's when everyone just pops off on him. Okay?
It's basically Ghostbusters.
Pardon?
Ghostbusters.
Yeah, it's basically Ghostbusters. You're just sliding the box underneath them and sucking
them out. Oh, yeah, yeah, it is that. And,
well, okay, yeah.
So, in a way, ranged might be like, well, I want to be on the boss this whole phase to make it shorter, but... the thing is, the more, like, as soon as the assault, here they should be on the flying mob, but as soon as the assault bots up and the tank has threat, everyone should just zug it, because then we can get him down to the ground, he'll take more damage, and the melee can attack him too. So usually it's only about 2 ground phases of 2 assault bots. Now the other thing that's going on here is there's bomb bots. I think one just ran right into the raid there. No, that's another junk bot. I haven't really been seeing them. Oh, there it is. So he drops them under himself. So let me go back there. So how you deal with bomb bots is they just kind of do a decent amount of AoE damage. They just run to someone and blow up pretty much. They don't do a crazy amount of damage. Like, you can heal through it, but you kind of want to mitigate damage, right? So you'll see it almost one-shot Precious there, who's a warrior. And so the mechanic, or what most people will do, is since the tanks aren't really doing things, we could have Isaac on one, and then Doze essentially can taunt one and just eat it. But if Doze can actually maybe DPS this fight, because you really only need a tank for the bottom phase, the tank guy. So what we can do is we can have DKs rotate. So when it drops the bomb bot, you pop AMS, you grip it, you just eat it for the raid, just get it out of there, and then the next DK does it. And we have 3 or 4 DKs, so that should be enough for the most part to cover most of them. Okay, any questions on that?
No, I don't think so.
Do you need to get out if you're a DK before you grip it?
Yeah, you get out of the raid, grip it, and pop AMS before, and you just blow it up. But yeah, you need to get out of the raid.
Who gets prior on member on set?
Slash roll.
But it's Memron's head does not drop from Memron.
Really? I didn't even know that. Okay.
Memron's head only Yogg drops from Yogg Zero.
Yeah, it's Zero. Yeah, it's the last thing we'll do. So if phase 4 is you have to now do every part of the fight at the same time, and just like High Prince Thakal or the Freya adds, if you don't kill them within a certain time of each other, they respawn. So once again, this is a cleave fight at the end here where you need to kill everything at the same time. How it works is the melee can hit the middle mob and the bottom mob, but they can't hit the upper mob. So the ranged mob, the ranged are almost exclusively on the top mob and maybe hit the middle if they need to catch up, whereas the melee are exclusively on the bottom and hit the middle when they need to catch up. Okay. You can pestilence between them all, like you can cleave pretty much everything, I believe, except the top mob as most melee. Now the only change between this and the other phases is he doesn't do all of his mechanics. So he just does a group of mechanics. So the things he'll still do are landmines. I don't believe he does the shock blast. I might be mistaken on that. But
he does do the shock blast.
Okay, he does do. So he's still doing landmines.
At least in hard mode,
he does.
I don't know if he does it normal or not.
I don't know if he does the, I'm not sure on that. I think he does do it in hard mode. I think you're right.
I don't think he does the missile on the ground.
He does do that, yeah.
He does do that? Okay.
So, I'm not sure if he does the tank buster. We can see if there's a DBM timer. But if you want to move all of them, you have to move the bottom mob. And so that's, in normal mode, you generally don't move him, but moving him will become more important on hard mode. We'll talk about why. So landmines are still going out, and now we have to deal with all the other mechanics. So what's going to come up here in a second is the middle mob is going to do the laser barrage. So we all need to get behind the little mob and not get hit by the lurker thing. Another great time to use rocket boots if you're going to die. Additionally, he can still do the missiles, and he's still just doing damage between the raids. So people usually should be kind of grouped up. No one should be kind of standing by themselves so they don't take too much damage from the middle mob's essentially auto attacks. The top mob, I don't think it really does. There's the shock blast. Yeah, it does it even on normal. I don't think the top mob does really anything special. It just still needs to be tanked.
As far as I know, that's correct. I don't remember it doing anything special either.
Yeah. You just have to kill it, just like everything else, and it will still be tanked. So that's pretty much it for Memron normal.
Whoop.
Sorry, I was just refilling my water. I'm dying.
I can hear you dying. Oh, wait.
That's iron. I'm not dying. My voice just hurts because I've been talking too much today. Now let's talk about hard mode and what changes. Pretty much. This one. The main change is this hard mode is called Firefighter. Because what's going to happen throughout all phases is there will be a DBM timer called Next Flames, pretty much. And I forget the exact ability, but when that timer goes off, there is he will spawn a fire patch on a random raid member, a couple random raid members. And it just picks wherever you happen to be. So what will happen is if you just ignore this mechanic, the fires will start to spawn everywhere. And just to make it a bit more crazy, these fires are like, fuck, what's the last boss of Hyjal?
Archimon?
They're Archimon fires. So they will see someone and they will chase them. They're not very fast or anything, but the fires will spread. And so you'll see flames soon here. And so what will happen is, throughout the whole fight now, you need to drop these fires in good places. So what your raid will do is you'll group up in certain spots that are convenient, like you'll get as close to the other fires as possible, group up, drop the flames, then move to a safe spot in the map here. So how, I don't really like how they do it here. Let me look at this one. I think like there's more.
Frost bomb's going out now.
So what they'll do is they'll use the corners. So they pull it, the landmines drop right there, and they're just kind of going to drop the fires over on this third here. So you'll see the fires are over there right now. They don't have to worry about that. They're just dealing with the other abilities. But you'll see the napalm shells. You can't really see here, but those are the... I watched this guild progress, and that's what most people were dying to, is they just weren't getting heals to that, or they were dying to stupid shit like landmines and other one-shot mechanics like Shock Blast. So, since you can move this mob, it's pretty easy for the tank to just take it in a circle. This first phase, in terms of the fires, is not very difficult. What makes it even easier is one of the abilities he will do is called Flame Suppressant. And so I just want to pull this one up, just to fact check myself.
Put them out?
What?
Huh?
Yeah, sorry, I misheard you. It will put all the fires currently out, but it does do a bad thing, which I'm double checking, because I think it interrupts spell casting, but I might be wrong. Just give me a sec. Tactics. Slows the casting speed of the raid by 50% for 8 seconds. So once again, you can Ice Block or Divine Shield. You might be able to conquer this, but I'm not sure. So on top of everything, now we have to deal with, you know, a DPS decrease and healing slow heals. So this fight, in terms of the fires, phase one is what I mean, is not that hard. You don't really have to worry about it. Just don't die of the other mechanics. Usually you don't run out of space and deal with the flame suppressant. Be aware, you can use Aura Mastery probably, okay?
There's no range on flame suppressant, right?
No, I don't think so. I think it just hits everything and puts all the flames out.
Okay.
So you'll see flame suppressants coming up here. There's a shock blast. Just went out, and you'll see all the fires are now gone. You'll also see next flames is coming up in 10 seconds, so we'll see what we do. They're killing him right now, so this is a really good example of you'll see how they stack the flames. They're all kind of coming to here, and I think the other raid does it even better. So the flames are about to spawn. They're all grouping up in just some spot in the map that they don't care about, and then they run away. So that way the fire is out of the way of the rest of the fight, right? So whenever you can safely and conveniently group up like that, you want to. And you'll see they're already spreading towards them. Now, the next phase is actually the hardest in terms of the fire. So much so that on hard mode, most guilds will opt to pop Lust here. On normal mode, it usually makes sense to Lust in the last phase when you need to kill them all within the certain time frame. So here's the other guilds. They actually were managing flames a bit worse there, but with the flame suppressants, really not a big deal. So once again, they do the exact same thing. When they kill him, they're all just grouping up until the fire drops. There it is, and they start moving. Okay, so the next phase is the exact same thing as normal, but what makes it difficult is since you have the fire, you don't want people to be in a full circle around him because the fire is just going to be all the fucking over the place. So what you'll do is you'll have the raid stack on one third, and melee can go behind him to avoid damage, but you essentially are all soaking the damage together for the most part. If you are on the other side, you want to be kind of close. You'll see they have some people, but they're mostly heavied on one side. They'll pop lust at the start, and the new mechanic is called Frost Bomb. So we'll have a cast timer, there it is, and watch what happens. Just look above his head. He shoots out like a missile that arcs into the sky, and you see it just landed over to the left. You see that blue thing right here? Everyone see that?
Yep.
That's the Frost Bomb. And it's just, they added another one-shot mechanic. So after a certain delay, it will blow up. And the nice thing is it will put out fires, but it will one-shot you. Aside from that, this mechanic is, this phase is pretty much the exact same. But you just want to kill it very quick, because since you're kind of still spreading around the boss and you still have to do the spinning up and stuff like that, if there's fire everywhere and this laser barrage is going on, it becomes very hard and chaotic to not die. Make sense?
Yeah.
The last phase, let me see. I'm trying to remember what... Oh, I know what he adds in the last phase. He will add a new type of ad. And what these guys are called is, they're called like a fire extinguisher bots or something. We'll see here in a sec. Firebot. They don't need to be tanked or anything. They just run around and they'll actually put out fires, which is great. We generally like them. However, they do have a downside. Let me just pull up right here. Emergency Firebot, they do an AoE silence 15 yards. It's pretty massive. So once again, we can try and use Conch Aura and stuff like that to try and minimize the damage they do. So we're now in an odd spot where they actually also do the water spray on the fire that does frost damage. It does a shit ton of damage. So if you get hit by that cleave, it will knock you back and almost kill you. So it's kind of a catch-22. We want to kill these things because they're very dangerous, but we don't want to kill them all because they actually do help us. And a lot of the time, you can just leave them alone. They put out the fires and just pull the mob away. So in this last one, how they'll handle air phase, once again, they're going to group up because the flames are coming. And that's how tight they're grouping, right? Perfectly stacked. In this one, what you'll generally do is you'll use a third of the... sorry, this is the wrong one. You'll use a third of the room at a time. And so I believe from the those beams is where the ads are going to spawn. Just gives you a heads up. So they're kind of just pulling the ads away from the fire. And you can see Emergency Firebot over here kind of just fucking off and doing its own thing. Doesn't need to be tanked. It's putting out the fire for us. So as long as we're not near them, they're not a problem. But if one is in the raid, it needs to die ASAP. Like it is... threat number one to wiping us, because if it silences everyone or does a lot of AoE frost damage, we could die to it, right? But
yep.
Since it's going to the fire and we don't want to be near the fire, we just move in a clockwise fashion and kind of just stay away from them. It's not a big deal. Now, the last phase, nothing's going to change other than he's going to continue to do some of these mechanics, I believe including the frost bomb. I have to double check that. We'll see if he does it here in a second. But what's hard is you have to deal with the fires still and all the other mechanics. What's good is we can move the boss. So once again, we're going to kite him in a kind of a circle pattern. There's just a lot of other threats about it, right? Because we still need to deal with the barrage, still need to deal with shock blast, the landmines. And so you can see how this fight, it just becomes very difficult and chaotic to not die. Like, even really good players are going to, I guarantee you, everyone, the best player in the guild, doesn't matter, everyone's going to die to something very stupid in this fight. It's going to happen while we learn. It just is.
I'm glad that you called me the best player.
I'm not upset they called me stupid.
You don't even want to see me progging my first couple times on this fight. It was pretty messy.
Here it is, this group that we're looking at now.
This that we're seeing, this is an incredibly sweaty guild, but it's their first clear through.
Okay.
Because you can see, in after all of these, they get all the achievements pop up. So I believe it's probably first week, and this guy's in like progress. So, and he's done so many PTRs or private servers worth of clears, and got like realm firsts and stuff. So, so you'll see they're not really moving around a ton. It doesn't. It's just as kind of needed, right, Isaac?
Huh? What do you mean?
Like he's not. Like they're even keeping him pretty close to the fire and kind of like they're trying to maximize how much fire they can squeeze in one area, and then you know when it starts to get really hairy, bring it out, because you just don't want to run out of room too quick. And they lost like half the room. What they got. Any questions about firefighter before I move on?
Sure, there'll be a lot of questions the day of.
Yep. I hope not. I'm not answering them. okay, let's go over Vessax. Vessax should be pretty quick. And then I can probably do them in 15 minutes, then the last 30 minutes for Yogg.
You're not answering questions tomorrow, this guy.
Just... No, I'll answer questions. I'm partly memeing, but they're going to be quick answers, and I'm not doing boss explanations. Like, we're just pulling, and I'll call shit out as needed. Because a lot of stuff, like, not everyone needs to know. I'll quickly show you the trash. It's really not that big of a deal. It can be very dangerous. It can completely blow you up, but it's not hard to deal with. So you have a Twilight Adherent. He's like a priest or some type of healer. You just kill him first. Then there's going to be a Fire Mage and a Ice Mage. You just want to somehow freeze or sheep or something like that on one of them. Aside from that, should be pretty tankable. The last mob is going to be a warrior, and then you have like a Fire Ellie that is owned by this Pyromancer, okay? So you kill the healer, then you kill whatever mage you didn't CC. So here they kill the Fire Mage and the Ellie. And they try to CC the Frost Mage. It looks like the Frost Mage is a bit more dangerous because it probably Novas, it shoots Frostbolt volleys. And so after his Fire Ellie, I believe they're going to kill the Mage. Yeah, they mark its skull and they do the Guardian last. And in this room, there's just 3 packs of these, okay? You don't even need to kill all of them. Usually you kill at least 2, just so you have enough room to avoid, to maneuver the boss. We might kill all 3 just on our first time so we have more room. After you kill these, there's just 2 big adds. And they don't do anything too special as far as I know. They will do shadow crashes, which is what the boss also does. They do a mind control, so they just cyclone me here. And the last thing they'll do is halfway through they'll spawn this void add that you just need to kill before you kill the other guy, okay? He spawns it, we all turn and kill the Void Beast, and then go to this. So, these guys are kind of like what the boss normally does, his mechanics, which we're going to get into next. Any questions on the trash?
That looks scary.
I think you can only have to kill one of the 2. You can actually kill him on the left side of the room and just squeeze right through. So, this is General Vessax. He is the Lobster Man, and he's one of the hardest... Sword. Yeah, he's one of the hardest hard modes. And the other thing that makes him difficult is you have to keep in mind, once we get to this point, he's kind of... we want to prog the hard mode, but we need to always leave enough time that we can do Yogg normal so we never lose Yogg loot if needed. Or you know what I mean? Like, if let's say Yogg only takes 30 minutes on normal, we can go till that last bit once we have all the other hard modes on farm. He, to me, isn't till after Algon. The reason being, Vessax and Yogg, they're in that central room, kind of with all the keepers, and so we can do our 1 hour of Algalon prog And then once we're out of the Owlon 1 hour, and we've done all the other keepers on hard mode, really, there's only XT, Flame Leviathan, him, and Yogg. And we've had to kill Flame Leviathan and XT to get to Owlon, so we'll spend the most... This will be the next boss we prog on. And the other reason we want to get him down is the caster trinket, which is best for everyone.
And hero sword.
Yeah, and hero sword.
Swords, excuse me.
So this guy, pretty much, I'll show you normal quick, but what you'll do is he has only a couple mechanics. Oh right, it's another video where they pull. And this is the big threat tank fight, by the way, and you'll see why. So we pull. So he will constantly do shadow crashes on a specific target. We'll show you a range perspective of how they deal with that. Pretty much, this shadow crash will one-shot anyone it hits. It's just like the old kingdom thing. It's like a black missile or like shadow spikes on Kill Jaden. It's very slow and arcing. You just need to get out before it hits the ground, otherwise you're dead. The other thing he'll do is Searing Flames. It's a cast that is kickable. So this is a big kick fight. Usually it's going to be the Frost DKs and the Enhance is taking care of it. I don't really want Warriors and Rogues kicking anymore. It's just a DPS loss for them. But essentially, if you don't kick it, he will do massive raid damage and probably just instantly wipe, okay? So you need to deal with them. They need to be kicked every single time. You need to do it pretty much perfectly. The other mechanic he'll do is something called Mark of the Faceless, which you saw a bit ago. So right there, Mark of the Faceless on their Shadow Priest, let's say. And what this is it puts a dot on them, and any it leeches, it's like a soul leecher, life drain. It will do damage to them and heal Vessax, but it also does AoE damage and heals AoE damage. So this priest needs to get out of the raid, otherwise he will grief the whole raid, the boss will heal, and it can be a wipe in some scenarios. And this happens throughout the whole fight, okay? So this is constantly, pretty much you're doing this fight in two stacks. The melee stack and the range stack. We'll get into what some of the nuances of the range stack. But that person that gets this needs to run out. Now, melee are untargetable by this. If you're within 15 yards or something like that of the boss, you can't be targeted. If you are a melee and run out, though, you can then be targeted, and if you come back in, you're griefing. The other thing is if everyone is too close to him, like if you just try stacking on him, he will just start you doing on random people, even a melee, okay? So that's so you can't cheese him. Now, the other big thing that is going on throughout the whole fight is he is a big tank buster. So he has a cooldown called Surge of Darkness. It's coming up here in a couple seconds. And pretty much, it's going to buff himself, I believe. We'll see if he gets a buff here.
It's pickable?
I don't know how it failed there. Maybe he did get it. I think it just showed up. It is there. That's it. And see, General Vessax roars and searches with Dark Might. So while he has this buff, you need a pain sub, a hand sack, you need a shield wall, just something. If you don't, the tank's probably dead. Okay, just straight up. Mm-hmm. So just like, I'm just going to keep calling them tank busters, you just need to use a cooldown. So that is the core of what you're doing in the fight. But there's a couple things now that make the fight hard. The first thing is he has an aura around the raid, Aura of Despair or something, this purple buff, that makes it so you don't get mana back, which makes him a lot harder than he should be because the boss has a lot of health. So let me just pull up quickly exactly what is affected by this, because it's not everything. Essentially, the buff is there to affect healers, primarily. It's there to make the fight healing intensive and long and grindy, and if your healers run out of mana or you don't kill them quick enough, you just kind of wipe. It does kind of hurt some of the caster DPS, but not as much as healers. We'll get into some of the reasons why. So, let me just find up the aura. prevents mana generation from natural sources, the following abilities are at least partially effective. So, Aspect of the Viper. So, hunters can do something so they don't go in. Judgment of the Wise, we can still judge wisdom, so people can benefit.
So you can, exactly. So get your snowballs ready, healers, to throw your snowballs to get 2% of your max mana back.
It's funny, I was thinking the same thing when I read it. Shaman Rage still works, to some extent. One thing.
Well, it's a different thing, isn't it? Like, if you scroll down, isn't it like Shamanistic?
You get the mana back, but reduced healing.
Yeah.
So it's essentially kind of like a berserk.
What about Viper?
Sorry, what was that?
What about, like, Aspect of the Viper for hunters?
Aspect of the Viper works. At least to some extent. It might be nerfed a bit, but it works. Spiritual Attunement, I believe that's a Pali thing. I'm not an expert.
Yes, that's the Pali mana back.
And Divine Plea. Oh, is that when you get healed, you get mana?
Yeah, heal. And
Divine
and
Plea apparently works.
And I looked it up, and so does the... When I block, I get mana back, too. That works, too.
Additionally, it will reduce melee attack speed. Pretty much, this is not a great melee fight. You still can pump, and you're very important. You need to do the kicks and stuff, and some other things that we're going to get into, but the casters will carry this fight. The reason being, this Shadow Crash that slowly arcs out towards the raid, and let's say all the casters are grouped, so it will say... Shadow Cross on Meow, for example. So what needs to happen is everyone, wherever Meow was standing, this is why we're grouping, everyone just spreads away, waits till the Shadow Crash hits, and after impact it will leave a black bit of tar, essentially. It will increase magic damage by 100%, so this is a buff fight, also your casting speed by 100%, but it reduces your healing taking, and it also reduces mana cost by 75%. Okay, and this right here is why casters don't really have mana problems in this fight, okay? It's really the healers, because what's going to happen is the casters want to be in this puddle pretty much the whole time, because they're absolutely cranking damage in here, and they're using less mana, but they're harder to heal, okay? Now, I'll show you what this looks like, because he has an affliction lock. Perspective. Okay, so they're standing in the black bit of tar. It's already dropped once, and so you'll see he has that buff. And everyone is pretty much here. The only people that would potentially be out is healers, and we'll get into some of the nuances of that. So he's just pumping, and you'll see Shadow Crash near you. He has some weak aura for it, but it's on Silhouette or something. And so everyone will split either left or right. Doesn't really matter. We can designate two groups, but as soon as it lands, you stack back up because we want everyone to benefit from this buff. Make sense? Now, threat in this fight starts to become a problem because these casters are getting crazy buffed. It's usually locks, but this is a fight where we'll actually have to use Blessing of Salve. I don't know if my damage meter is a bit bugged here, but pretty much you'll see, if we go to the start of the fight, we have a bear tank, which is like pretty decent for threat, and like no one is even close, and these people all start catching up, like all the casters. So you need to kind of be aware of that, and that is the difficult part for a tank for this fight. Now, here we do normal with a bear, so you know any tank can do this on normal. It's not really that big of a deal. On hard mode, it might be a bit more difficult for some.
Should we just like pump all the tricks into the the tank?
Every tricks, every MD goes to the tank on this fight, 100%, except maybe the first for. Affliction Warlocks, but even that one, probably not.
I mean, if they're the ones that catch up, probably not.
Yeah, exactly. But
your Warlocks are gonna want to wait as long as possible before they Soul Shatter.
Yeah,
Yeah.
They want to get as much value
as
possible.
If you use it early on, you're just going to catch up so quickly.
Yeah.
So you have to wait as long as possible.
So one other thing I want to say about this black tar thing, it's reducing healing done, not healing you take. So sorry if I miscommunicated that. So if healers are in this, they cannot heal. Okay, so it's only ranged DPS stand in this and reduce their mana. Hunters can do it too. It will still reduce their mana. So the DPS are generally cruising for mana on this fight. It's the healers. Okay, so on normal, what you can do is these serenade papers.
I want to note the dispriest is fine doing it though, because it's shielding. It's not healing.
Oh, true.
So you can just walk in and bubble.
Now, let me pull up my video because this is normal. Now, okay, what will happen is there's these clouds of serenite vapors. You can see one right there, okay? And it just floats around, doesn't need to be tanked or anything. And if you kill these, they will drop a green puddle on the ground. And you can see it right over there. There's the healer standing and two healers standing over there. So now we're now talking about normal, okay? And so on normal, you kill these things so your healers don't go oom. Okay, if you're not killing it quick enough and your healers are going oom, you need to kill the vapors, otherwise you're gonna wipe. And so there's a couple ways to do this. The common way is you'll have a DK, grip them in, you'll see me do it a couple times here, and you'll just have the melee kill it. So I think I do it right here, and you kind of just do want to do convenient ones. So I see this one pretty much coming right into us. I grip it to a better spot, you can chains it or whatever and kill it. Now the melee don't want to stand in there, and we'll get to why in a second, but the healers will then move in here, and what the green tar pit will do is it will give you mana back. Let me just go here. So it will give you a stacking debuff that gives you mana back and you take damage. And it can stack up to you taking, I believe, 25k per tick and getting 12k mana back. So that's around 8 stacks. So generally, you kind of want to just get to about 5 stacks and get out. 5 stacks will get you, I believe, it's consistently giving you mana back. And you're taking about 3k damage. Very healable, and you're getting mana back. So you don't want to, and the other thing is the melee don't want to stand in this. Ever really only healers should be standing this, because it's extra damage the healers have to heal, and they're the ones we're trying to save their mana. Okay, that is it for normal. Okay, that's the whole fight. So you're just dodging shadow crashes, healers go to this. The last thing I'll say about the green puddle is healers need to be careful not all to move at once, because what will happen is they'll see the first green puddle and they'll just say, oh, I'm going to go get mana back. All the healers move, the tank dies. So you want to designate 2 healers to go in at a time, okay? Never all of your healers. Now, doing this on hard mode, what you do is you don't kill any of the vapors, which means healers get no mana back. Essentially what the mana they start with is that that's it. They can snowball or try and do other things. Not sure if mana pots work, actually, strangely, but you only get one anyways, so even if they do.
I don't believe they do in that fight.
Yeah. So the hard mode is, since your healers aren't getting back, it's pretty much, can we kill it before our healers go oom? If so, we can do the hard mode. Now, what makes it even harder though is what will happen if you kill none of the vapors is once all 8 spawns, which is the total amount that will spawn during it. There, you just saw me kill it again for the healers. And what, one last note about the normal mode, if you're a DK doing this, I've ran out to grip it before, and then I've got the mark of the faceless, that is the dot that heals everyone, so you have to be very careful about that. Anyways, so on hard mode, let's go to it. Oh, one other note about normal. Isaac, it makes it a lot easier sometimes if you move the boss around on normal so that the healers don't have to move as much. And like, if
so you just grip in and then I move the boss.
Yeah. So what makes it on hard mode, you don't want to really move it away from the black tar pit. And you're not killing the green vapors anyways, so usually you just keep them in the same spot the whole fight. But on normal, you can feel free to move them around to position them so that the casters don't have to move as much. Or you can pull him near a vapor so that the melee can just cleave the vapor down for the healer, right? If we don't have a grip. Okay. Now, the reason this fight shouldn't take too long to go over is because the hard mode is not that different. Let me show... Yeah, his is in action. Oh no, he doesn't have it. So it does. Essentially, we won't kill any of the things, and you'll see they did leave the ad up here and didn't kill it. And they will just all start to be drifting around. So A, this is a griefable hard mode. If someone cleaves these vapors or something and kills one, we can no longer do hard mode, okay? You have to wipe at that point if we're trying to get the hard mode. So that's the other reason we're, they're kind of tanking them here on the corner to avoid that. Now what will happen is once all eight spawns, something, they'll coalesce and form into a mob, which you'll see in a second here. It's generally about 40%, but I believe it's time-gated. It's just once they all spawn. Where is it? Here it is. So, you'll see Serenite Vapors are... They're merging into a monstrous form. Serenite Barrier appears around Vesax. So what will happen is there's now a new mob that needs to be tanked, okay? Additionally, Vesax has a barrier, and we can't damage him. We can't just finish the fight. So you need to now kill a second mob before you finish Vesax. So not only is the hard mode you can't don't get mana back, but there's more damage to do. And additionally, what this mob does, he doesn't do too many mechanics other than he does a constant pulsing damage. I believe it's this stack right here, 13, 14, about to turn 15. It's kind of like Muru. He just does more and more AoE damage, making, once again, this a very big mana check for healers, okay? We need to kill this thing fast before the raid is just taking too much raid damage, okay?
Do you just focus that and then go back into Zex?
Yeah, pretty much. That's it. It's pretty straightforward, but it's just going to be tuned very hard, potentially.
The trash, right? On the way to Vezix, in the hallway.
Yeah, we talked about
before it. You get to his room, will give you practice for this. The Voidwalker spawns, and you have to kill it before you kill the Faceless. Yep. Same type deal.
So what's going on through this phase, though, is you still do need to deal with Shadowcrash, which is kind of a blessing because that way the casters don't go oom, and Mark of the Faceless. It looks like he doesn't cast Surge, the thing on the tank, and it looks like he also doesn't cast the Searing Flames. I might be wrong about that, but I'm guessing he doesn't cast Searing Flames because he can't kick.
I don't believe so. I believe that's correct. I believe he just autos the tank. Because
I don't see... He had pop-ups for Searing Flames.
Yeah, I think he's just autoing the tank and maybe casting Shadow Crashes during that phase.
Yeah, it looks like there's no timer. But when it dies here, he does surge pretty much right after. So be careful of that. Any questions on Vesax before we move on? That's pretty much it. There's not much to the hard mode, like I said. It's just hard.
It just looks like a lot of movement for the...
Casters,
for the range, or for the casters, yeah.
But they're absolutely cranking, like... DPS meters,
yeah. Right? I see it. They also have, what, 7 warlocks in that group? Yeah,
all doing over 10k.
They have Destro locks.
Okay, I just gotta grab some more water. 1 sec.
I don't think those are Destro locks.
They were actually where?
They just were?
Probably because of the 100% cast speed. Yeah. I don't know.
Maybe.
Yeah.
I saw a couple chaos bolts this way.
Maybe there's like some type of resistance or something. Chaos bolts just go straight through resistance. I don't know.
Destro locks also get health back from casting Shadow.
They do.
So yeah. They can life tap, they can kind of cheese the mechanic. I don't know if that's the reason why, but that's something that they can do.
That is a good shout.
Yeah.
and then a warrior show.
I see an affliction and demo on the top, so listen.
Yeah.
I don't know if that's true.
Affliction and demo is like top even right now.
That's what I'm saying. Yeah, but what they're saying is there are five demo locks in this raid. Or four.
Four destruction.
Destruction, excuse me.
Oh, yeah. I don't know what's up with that. Could be details bug.
It's either details bug or it's because Destro has a thing that benefits a lot from the super fast cast speed and like as a way to cheese the mana.
Yeah, it could be. They could just have dual spec for this fight for Destro.
Okay. And Psycho was saying that it might because they heal from their damage.
Yeah, but don't you heal from haunt damage too?
Maybe not as much as because you're doing a shit ton of damage and here.
I thought haunt was like super big. Am I wrong?
I don't know if it's that big.
I didn't play Locked during Wrath, so I couldn't speak to that.
I think it's like 100% of the damage you dealt over 12 seconds is returned to you. You're still returning to healing for 100% of the damage you did to the target. Yeah.
Yep.
So haunt heals you for a ton.
Yeah, I don't know why they're doing it. Destro has a mana replenishment.
It could be a replenishment thing.
You're right. Destro has a mana replenishment, but they also have they also get immunity to shadow damage too.
Oh, they do. Too. Yeah,
they get immunity to shadow damage, so they can stand in the shadow crash. They can stand in the shadow crash longer. That's what it is.
Nether protection.
That's what it is. Yep.
They still didn't beat the other locks, but probably because they, what's it called?
They're bad.
They're just helping out the healers, honestly. Yeah. But yeah.
Okay. We're now going to talk about Yogg-Saron. I'm going to just show this fight because there's so many mechanics.
There's so much stuff going on in that fight.
And then we'll talk about some of it and the difference between the hard modes. This one, for some reason, I can't find my 25, so we're going to show my 10-man on normal, and then we'll watch their hard mode clear.
You want to see a 25-man from the point of view of a warrior?
I got a couple. I have a warlock in hand, so...
Okay. I've got the recording of my server first one.
So this one, pretty much, it's going to have three phases, okay? First phase is pretty straightforward. What's going to happen is... we go in here, and you can't get past this phase until we do enough damage to Sarah. She just stands in the middle, and the only way you can actually damage her, because she's a green mob, is by killing an ad near her, and that will do an explosion and do damage. Seraph's Fervor, I kind of forget what it is, I'll check in a second. I believe it's just some damage dot or something like that. But these adds essentially just need to be tanked, and they need to be brought into the middle. Now, what also is happening is the adds are spawning from the clouds, okay, just on a timer. But the clouds will chase people, and if people go in the clouds, they'll spawn an extra add, okay? Phase 1 really is not a hard part of the fight. It takes a bit to get used to, and we're actually doing it the more difficult way. But usually what you'll do is you'll have a pally tank in the middle that can taunt multiple adds and pull it in when it gets low. This is kind of the boomer strat where we're actually dodging clouds and stuff and then pulling it in when it gets low. Now what will also happen is when they die, they'll do a big raid damage. So you generally want to use, like you can use Imp Shadow Aura or you can use a raid sack on it. Now I'll show you the kind of more... meta strat quickly for this phase. And this is the enhance again, and they're getting brown first here, zero light. Pretty much what they do is they just have, they stack all the melee, all the tanks, everyone's just in the middle, and if they spawn an extra ad, who cares? They're just cleaving it down and just sugging it, because the quicker they kill the things, the quicker they get to phase two anyways. So the range, they still have dodging, but everything else, they're just slugging down, pretty much. Now, they also do a weird cast when they're about to finish and die.
I said, do you know how to do this minigame? And I said, right-click boss.
I don't have my other video, but on some private servers, the one I was playing, it was kickable and you could stop the damage you take. I don't know if that's going to be realistic, though. Overall, I don't want to spend too much time on this phase, though, because it's not that hard, and you'll get it down pretty quick.
Where is this going?
Do you take damage for being in the middle?
From the clouds? No. You take damage the adds when they blow up, though.
Right. I was just wondering.
It has, like, infinite range, pretty much.
I gotcha, okay.
So, Sarah's Fervor, she will heal a friendly target, she will increase a friendly target's damage, but increase damage taken. So she'll cast that on the adds, and she'll also heal them, and inflicts shadow damage, and she has some dot, okay? Nothing you can do about it, and then there's these adds that blow up when they die, okay? Dark volley should be interrupted. Yeah, so there's two things. They blow up when they die, but they can also do a volley of shadow damage that looks the exact same as when they die, and so you can interrupt the volley, and so what happens is they coincidentally usually do the volley when they're about to die, and so both will happen and you can take a lot of damage.
They die during the volley cast, it goes off, is that what you're saying? Or do you
just just completely two separate mechanics, but it will time out sometimes that if you don't kick it, the volley will go out and then they'll blow up when they die, and you'll take two things.
Okay.
Once you finish this phase, and you just need to kill enough near her, I think we actually wipe here. This is our hard mode progression. We did like 10 attempts, and sometimes you'll just fuck up and get too many and just die. That's what a phase one wipe looks like. It's not pretty.
This is very good music. I'm enjoying it.
Go into the actual kill attempt here. Okay. Phase 2 is kind of like C'Thun phase 2 pretty much. He's pretty much protected. He's in that bubble, so we can't actually DPS Yogg yet. So instead, you have to deal with... it's just like C'Thun where we need to do something to damage him. And I'll explain what that is in a second. But in the meantime, we need to kind of just survive and deal with some adds. The type of adds you get, the first one is right here. It's a constrictor tentacle that will actually grab someone and squeeze them. And if you don't kill it quick enough, they'll just kill them. So those are always top priority. The second priority are these corruptor tentacles, at least for melee. This is the only other thing melee can attack in Yogg's room here during phase 2. And they're just essentially spellcasters. You can kick them and just damage them. They're kind of like warlocks. The other thing you'll get is big claw tentacles, like you'll see over there. And melee should never go on these. They don't reposition Isaac and like hit people like they do for C'Thun. So range can just slowly kill them, okay? So essentially what you'll do is everyone will kill the constrictors, then the melee will get the corruptors, and the ranged will focus on the big claw ones, okay? The other things going on in this phase, there's two big things, is you see these green laser beams? That's a telegraph saying, I'm about to start blasting that area, and he'll do a kind of four areas around him, and as soon as it starts like pulsating like that, it becomes a one-shot kill, and it just goes in a little pattern around it. It's pretty easy, you just dodge it. It moves slow like that, just don't stand in it, okay? And you can see how close that bear went to it and didn't die. No one should die to that. Very easily avoided. And you have a lot of time to move away before it starts. There it started. Okay? The other thing that will happen, and you'll see someone's getting squeezed from another constrictor, so you gotta break them out, is this brain link. So he'll pick two people in the raid, and he'll put a link between them. And you see that red beam right there? Sorry, it's a bit small. Everyone see that?
Mm-hmm.
If those two players move farther apart from each other, the beam will become more red, and as the further they get, the more damage they'll take. So it's essentially the opposite of Mother Shiraz. So those two people are now glued together and need to stay close to each other. And when they're really close, the beam turns like green and you take no damage. See, it actually disappears when I think you get close enough. And there's another one. You'll see those two players getting close. The only
heroic sludgefish.
Yeah, and the only exception to this is what we need to do. You can break the beam by going through the portals. And so why we're going through these portals? Well, the portals is how you actually make Yogg vulnerable and get into phase 3. So every once in a while, portals will just spawn around them on DBM timers, and you'll see me looking for the portal here. And we're going to send, usually you send your melee through, or any arranged that has a lot of instant cast. Boomkins are also great, obviously, because of Starfall. And so what happens is in here, there's just some adds to kill. And once you kill them, you'll get to the brain of Yogg. One thing I need to explain quick, which I've kind of skipped, is as soon as you get to phase 2, you're going to have a debuff on you called Sanity. Okay? And this starts in phase 2. Let me just pull it up here. It will start at 100 and go towards 0. And once it reaches 0, you are permanently mind controlled, just like Velmist, okay? You're essentially dead to us. We need to kill you, and then we can either battle res you or you're just dead, okay? So you start at 100 sanity, and how it works is when you take damage from certain mechanics, your sanity goes down. And when it hits 0, you're mind controlled. So a couple things that can decrease your sanity is that brain link, when you're stuck together like that, if you fuck that up, you can lose sanity there. But the main thing that you lose sanity to in phase 2 is in the portal realms, actually. And what will happen is there's just some yellow mobs that you just need to go kill. But what they will do is occasionally they will start doing this crazy mind play. These ones don't do it. I got lucky here. I just go in here and kill these. No big deal. But see over there, you see that Tesla thing? Essentially, they'll turn into like a skull, and they'll start zapping you for shadow damage. So you need a couple healers to go through here, usually a Disc Priest, or it could be a Holy Priest for the speed boost. Someone that can move and heal pretty easily. And what you need to do is you can break the beam and stop taking damage if you look away from it. So you need to actually physically not look at it. And while that purple beam is on you and you're taking damage, you are losing your sanity stacks, okay? So melee need to be very conscious of this, and they need to be quick. So you'll see in a second, sorry to replay again, but as soon as it's on me, I turn away and I can still DPS. I just try and break all the beams and not look at them, okay? Once you kill all the adds in this room, you can then pop rocket boots. This is the time you pop rocket boots. Never before this, you never pop rocket boots to kill the adds, okay? Always pop them at this stage, because what will happen is you now have a limited amount of time to attack the brain of Yogg-Saron. Once you kill this thing, you get into phase 3 permanently. This is kind of like being in the stomach for C'Thun, okay? But you only have limited DPS time in here because he's casting this uninterruptible induced madness. And when this thing finishes, if you're still in the brain, you're just permanently mind controlled. You go back out to the main room and we need to kill you. Okay? So the DPS will stay in here and we will pump and pop our haste bots, whatever, and get out when the timer is less than 5 seconds before you get mind controlled. Okay? Now, the other thing about that is, since your raid isn't in like the same zone, you can lust the people that are in there without lusting the people that aren't in there. So during prog, we might choose to use like a melee lust in there to kill the brain quicker or to push the phase, okay? But that won't lust the people upside. If you... ideally, we want lust in phase 3, and we'll talk about some of the reasons why. You'll see the brain phases kind of change. They're not always the same. They're different rooms. The ads are kind of in different spots. But once you kill them all, the brain opens up. And these portals are happening, like, once you go in the first portal as a melee, there's not much time where you're up. You come out of the portal, you kill, like, maybe an ad, like a constrictor, or maybe two, and then you're back in the brain. So usually on 25... with good DPS, it will be 2 brain phases. More likely during prog, it will be 3. If it's 4, I don't know. Who knows with the tuning and the pre-nerf they're doing and all that shit. But historically, it's been kind of 3 for prog and 2 once you're nailing the fight. Okay, so you get squeeze all the damage out, and here we're doing 3. This was our first 10 man. It's pretty much the same in 25. And so you also kind of just want to stay on the close side of him, so you can always hear I'm getting squeezed and they need to break me out. That's what that looks like. Okay? So you pretty much just rinse and repeat until you start phase 3. Okay? And here we're going to break it. Sorry, apparently we did.
Oh, as a tank in this phase, do I just like... jerk off or
yeah, kind of. Yogg is usually one tanked. You can 2 tank it, and for yeah. Zero Light you'll use 2 tanks, but it's not a very tanking intensive fight.
Yeah. I'll show you how to do it. I think it's all I do these days.
And so much to a point, phase 3, you don't even get to tank the boss. You don't have to. He's not a tankable boss. But phase 3 starts here. What you do tank is these Immortal Guardians. And so how these guys work is, first off, they're immortal. The only thing that can kill them is Thorim.
Yeah.
And so the keepers are around the room, okay? And this is when we talk about 1 light, 2 light, 3 light, 4 light. Once you kill all the keepers, they go to the room above Yogg, and you can talk to them and ask for their help during
Yogg. He said it was dab time. And he wasn't wrong.
To get what they provide is these buffs. Mim will give move speed, and he will reduce the attack speed of ads and tentacles and casting speed of tentacles. Freya will increase the healing received, and she will provide sanity buffs. We'll get to those in a second. Thorim will increase our health and periodically kills a weakened Immortal Guardian. So what that means is when those adds get to 10, like 1% health, like really low health, he will deliver the last hit. He is the only thing that can kill these adds, okay?
Yeah.
So here, you'll see, we'll get into kind of what the DPS is doing. Let me just finish the other buffs.
Could be.
For Hodir will reduce the damage we take, and he gives raid members a cheat death every once in a while. Has an internal cooldown, but if they die, he'll encase us in a block of ice so we can be healed, and you can click it off. Okay. Let me show you the sanity wall quick.
So?
So here. What will happen is I'm below 41 stacks of insanity, and honestly, you can push it even lower than this. But what I'll do is I'll run to the green well. And so there's about 4 of these that are on the outside of the room. We'll see, I'll do it in a second. And this is another time to use your rocket boots if they're up. This is a very, very long fight. So here I go rocket boot. And while I stand in this, it gives me my sanity back. You'll see it went from 29, 49. I should have stayed a bit longer. I went all the way to 100, but I left
at 69. Nice, this guy.
Yeah.
But now you're at 69.
Yeah. So let's talk about what else is going on in phase 3. So these ads are kind of special because they do a couple things. So let me pull up what Yogg does.
Dude, those wells have a limited amount that they.
Say that again?
Those wells have a limited amount that they bring back?
No, no. They're infinite. So Yogg only casts a couple abilities. First off, I want to talk about the ads. So the first thing he'll do is he'll empower an ad, causing them to regenerate health. Additionally, let me find empowered. The Immortal Guardian increases the damage it deals when its health value is high. Damage increased by 180% per stacks, begins at 9 stack, loses a stack for every 10%. Okay? So, when these mobs get empowered, they are going to do, what's 180 times 9? It's a lot. They're doing, like, what? Over 1,000 times their normal damage if they're full health. So what will happen is...
they hit very fucking hard.
Yes. They can absolutely one-shot tanks. And so what you need to do throughout this whole phase, the easiest way to deal with this, is just keep the adds kind of low health. You don't need to, like, get them to 1% right away. But once they're at 1%, Thorim is going to zap them like he just did there. So we don't have to worry about them. So we're just going to kind of constantly cleave them down and keep them low health so our tanks don't die. However, because the Shadow Beacon heals, and I believe it does AoE healing around it, how it works is when the mob gets targeted for Shadow Beacon, you need to either taunt or a hunter needs to distracting shot, and we need to pull it away from the other mobs and away from Yogg, otherwise we will grief and this phase will go on forever. And on top of that, the mob is going to heal and potentially be able to kill the tank, right? So, let's talk about the hard mode of this fight. We already kind of hinted at it. One mechanic first. One last mechanic. And that is the
She's just typing instead of fucking getting on a goddamn boat.
Okay. Yeah, this is the drain life. So, transfers health from a random player to a mortal guardian. The last thing that he will do on normal here is lunatic gaze, and he will inflict shadow damage and reduce your sanity, and it's a channeled as long as you're facing him, just like the other ads. So this whole phase, what it is let me go to the start. First off, it's gonna start and he's already pretty much in execute phase, so this is an amazing fight to tricks the affliction locks as soon as you get to phase 3.
All right, guys, felt it.
So here's phase 3, and pretty much you want to be attacking Yogg as much as possible, but when you see these purple things, you want to turn away. And what this means to Melee is, oh, I just turn around and hit the adds. So how it works is, Melee is you're constantly swapping between the add and Yogg. Right. As soon as it stops, here I should be on Yogg, and see I turn and swap. It's kind of weird with Frost DK, I was usually waiting for Pestilence cooldown to kind of time it. But he's constantly doing it, so just watch the timer here. So we can now attack him for 6 seconds. I'm on Yogg, and I turn away. Ideally, you want to turn away before it starts, and now I'm on the ad. And this is where people need to be responsible and manage their sanity stacks, because you're constantly losing them in phase 3, unless you're doing this mechanic absolutely perfectly, okay? Now, a couple tricks you can do. Casters can position themselves kind of between Yogg and the adds, so it's easy when they're not on Yogg, they can DPS the adds as well and not take it. Healers, it's super easy. You literally can just turn around and not worry about your sanity stacks, just never look at Yogg, and it's not a problem for you. Warlocks are historically OP for this fight because they can literally drain life while looking away from him, so they can just be on the boss the whole fight and just be absolutely pumping him for the most part, and just turn around when they need to reapply a dot or something like that, okay?
No, you cocking.
The other really strong thing is rogues are really good on this fight because they can spam Fan of Knives. This is more so for a zero light thing to DPS the adds and Yogg, okay? Phase 3 is long and grindy. He has a lot of health even in execute range. It is not a quick fight. Like, it feels like it's fucking taking forever, especially if your DPS aren't good at turning back and forth and swapping targets quickly without... the other thing that lowers your DPS is people might need to go to the wells and stuff, and healers need to coordinate going to the wells, so there's always a healer there, right?
Are you sure?
Do we know if his face is his face, or if I can shred his face?
I'm not positive.
Really? Ooh.
That is the best part.
Shred his face, I love it. Inspire, Affliction Locks, and Mind Flayer actually kind of reign supreme because channeled.
Yeah. So, let's talk about Hard Mode. That's pretty much normal.
Arcane Missiles OP is what you're saying.
The only thing I didn't go over here, really, was all the abilities of the tentacles, which it really doesn't matter. They're like warlocks. It's whatever. Now, what changes on Hard Mode is you can do this boss in several difficulties. You can do them with all four keepers, or you can drop a keeper. Each time you drop a keeper, I'm guessing it's like Mimran or Freya, where the first one you drop, you probably just get an extra Crusade or Ruined Orb or whatever. And what you probably drop more and get a pattern. You don't get the bonus loot, as far as I know, until you get to one light. That means you only left up one keeper. Now, which keeper you leave up is important, because they provide these buffs. Now, there's two ones that are very important to making this fight not very difficult.
Yeah.
The first Freya one is Freya. She allows you to drop stacks, okay? The second one is Thorim. If you don't leave Thorim up, the adds are literally immortal, okay? And we still need to DPS them, otherwise they're going to kill the tanks. And they're piling up because they're now immortal, right? So they're just we're just getting more and more and more adds. And if you, it's very easy to get overwhelmed. And if you do the Shadow Beacon wrong and it heals all of them, it can just get chaotic really quick. It's generally agreed if you do One Light Yogg, what keeper you leap up is actually Thorim. The adds are harder than the sanity stacks. And what this means is Yogg Hard Mode, for us, everyone needs to play perfectly and you get 100 sanity for the whole fight. You don't get to refresh it and go up the whole fight. These wells will not be there on Hard Mode, okay? That's the only difference between Hard Mode. That and, you know, we're going to not be as quick. We're going to get less healing. We're not going to have as much health. We won't have cheat deaths. We will take more damage. So, it's kind of like a world buff fight. There might be... This is going to be the last Hard Mode we do, by the way. It's generally the hardest, in my opinion. And it's going to take a lot of time and a lot of practice. And doing the fight on normal, you're still practicing for Hard Mode, because you just want to, even if you're doing it normal in terms of parsing or doing good damage, you want to do the mechanics perfectly so you're not running over to that green pillar 5 times in a fight and not DPSing, right? Now that's Yogg One Light. Yogg Zero Light is the hardest version of the boss, and the only extra benefit is we get the Mimran's Head mount, okay? So we're going to go over what they do for Yogg Zero Light. Yogg One Light, the mechanics of the fight are the exact same. You just don't have the wells and the buffs. Make sense?
Yep.
Yogg Zero Light, you have an extra added difficulty here. Oops.
No, I'm not going to watch an ad.
No, it doesn't do it on this computer. It was just my other one. Okay. Let me find phase 3. It just has to load now, apparently.
Oh shit, we can hit him.
So, phase 3 starts, I believe right here. Oh no, it's even before this. Sorry.
Yep.
Okay, close enough. The last thing I'll say about this is how you finally forge Valinir once you have enough fragments. There's a step where he says he opens his mouth wide, and you just right-click the item, you throw it in his mouth, you kill the boss, you loot Valinir. It's kind of like a Oni in Classic. It's relatively easy, nothing too hard about it. The other thing I need to mention is he does get one additional ability that I forgot to mention that makes it harder on Hard Mode, and that's Deafening Roar. Where is it?
Is that with all four keepers or just three?
As soon as you have, I think, three one or
down.
Less.
No,
one down,
three or
yeah. And so this will do physical damage and silences enemies. Once again, improved concentration aura is very important, the aura mastery rather, is a very important mechanic and skill we need to learn for a lot of bosses in Alduar, and I don't think that changes for all of Wrath. At this point, when he does the roar, that's when you throw it out, and I believe, as well. And then you get Valinir, so just something to keep in mind. That makes the fight
harder. Right.
Now, what changes on Zero Light, which is the absolute hardest difficulty, is we have infinite adds. So how do we deal with that? A, you got to keep them low at all times. And this is where I'm talking about Fan of Knives and Rogues start to become very good in this fight. Because the adds are piling up. You have like over 10, okay? And this is generally, you'll only two tank the fight if you do Zero Light Log. But I think you can even one tank it. Because what's important, as long as the adds are low health, the tank won't get clapped, even if he has fucking 20 adds. So the adds need to stay, like, one health at all times. And the reason being is so the tank doesn't die, which is pretty much whenever the rogue can't attack Yogg, they spam Fan to keep everything low. And that's how you carry the fight. Originally, the boomer strat of doing this fight is they just stack the raid with, like, fucking 10 affliction locks and like 5 rogues, and they got it down. That's how they did it way back in the day. We probably won't need to do that, but that's kind of the strat and what classes are OP.
They'd be banished?
No.
Maybe
it's better than this. Okay. They cannot be CC'd at all.
And okay. So what will happen is he will shadow beacon an ad. So he put it on this one, DBM marked it star or whatever. And we need to pull this one out, otherwise it will heal all the adds and then the tank will die. So what you do is you have a hunter distracting shot it, just like he is over here. He'd pop retaliation or whatever, and hopefully the shadow beacon's done by that time, and he runs back in. So that's that hunter thing that we just saw there, that's really the only change between one light and zero light. You need to do that, otherwise you will have infinite adds and the tank will die all the time.
One quick note about that, on 25 man, he marks 3 adds and not 1.
Oh, sure.
So you have to take care of 3 adds at the same time to get marked and get healed.
Are you sure this is a 25?
I'm 100% sure.
Hmm. Maybe it doesn't on this server.
Unless they nerfed it on that server, but in the original classic, I was one of the ones that had to pull out the adds. We had 200s and me as a warrior had to do it.
Hmm. Interesting. But yeah, that's pretty much it for Yogg. I know I went 10 minutes past, but if you guys got any questions, I'll answer that. Otherwise, that's it.
I don't have any.
Give me
a fun one.
Yeah, I really appreciate you guys coming. I am going to continue to do these on Wednesdays, but we've done most of the hard bosses. We just need to do Araya, and then this Kalagarn. And then the siege bosses, which is just 4 bosses, Flame Leviathan, Next T, Ignis, and Razor Scale. We've done most of the really hard bosses, and those are the ones I wanted to prepare us for before, you know, PTR tomorrow, so.
We've kind of been going the order we get it down, except Yogg.
We've been doing Yogg Zero Light, hard mode order, pretty much. And the only hard modes we haven't talked about are Flame Leviathan and XT, and they're kind of awkward to do because they're the first and fourth boss of the raid, and they're both gatekeepers. So if we want to prog on other hard modes, we have to kind of kill them on normal or waste our prog time towards Algolon on like progging XC hard mode. So just the kind of the nature of the beast is those might be kind of shelved to later hard modes. The plan for Flame of Leviathan is we'll just do incremental difficulties for that one as we get more geared.
Your cat.
Also, everyone hates that hard mode. They think it's the most toxic thing ever to wipe to because it's a vehicle fight. So,
Flame of Leviathan. True.
Yeah. What were you saying, bro?
I think we'll just do all the hard modes week one. No big deal.
I mean, if PTR goes good enough. My plan for PTR is full clear on Thursday normal, and then on Tuesday we'll start adding hard modes. Because as you can see from a lot of these fights, learning on normal still prepares you for the hard mode, right?
Yeah, of course, yeah.